यूनिट वन इंट्रोडक्शन टू सिग्नल्स एंड सिस्टम्स पार्ट टू। So operations on signal a signal comprises of a set of information expressed as a function of any number of independent variable that can be given as an input to the system or derived as output from the system. To realize its true practical utility, the signal we derive out of the complex box, out of the complex system, might not always be in the same form as we want. So, being well with some basic signal operation, it may come really handy to enhance the understandability and the applicability of the signal. So there are some basic operations that are performed on the dependent variable, like amplitude scaling of the signal, addition of signal, multiplication, differentiation, integration, and so on. So first is time shifting. Now here x of t plus minus t0 is time shifted version of the signal x of t, where x of t is the original signal. The first figure shows it. X of t plus t0 is negative shift and x of t minus t0 is positive shift. Now the diagram for this time shifting is shown here. Now suppose that we have signal x of t and we define a new signal by adding or subtracting a finite time value to form it. Now we now have a new signal pi of t, then the mathematical expression for this would be x of t plus or minus t0. Then graphically this kind of signal operation result in a positive or negative shift of the signal along its time axis. However, note that while doing so, none of its characteristics are altered. This means that the time shifting operation results in the change of just the positioning of the signal without affecting its amplitude or span. So what is time shifting? Time shifting is nothing but the change of just its the change of the positioning of the signal without affecting its amplitude or span. Now let us consider example of the signal in the following figure, in which in order to gain the better insight into the above information. So your original signal is x of n from n equal to minus 3 to 3, and it has values minus 2, 0, 1, minus 3, 2, minus 1 and 3, which is shown in B, figure B. So the diagram shows the original signal and its time delayed signal. Next is time scaling. Now x of a t is the time scaled version of signal x of t, where a is always positive. If mod of a is greater than 1, then compression of the signal, and if it is less than 1, then the expansion of the signal. So first signal is the original signal, Second signal is x of 2t. As it is greater than 1, so there is a compression of the signal. And last one is x of t by 2. As t by 2 is less than 1, so there is expansion of signal, and here the signal is expanded. Now we understand, let us consider the input signal to be continuous time signal x of t. Now suppose that we multiply the independent variable t by a number greater than 1, then make the t into the signal, say 2t, then the residual signal will be like this, that is, there is a compression. The time scale signal is stretched by a factor of n version of the original signal. So the time scale signal is stretched by a factor of n version of the original signal. If we multiply the signal by its time variable by 1 by t by 1 by 2 instead of 2, then the time scale signal presents at the time instant, original signal presents at the time instant t equal to 1, 2 and 3 to be found at 2, 4 and 6 if it is t by 2. Now basically we perform the time scaling, we change the rate at which the signal is sampled. Changing the sampling rate of the signal is employed in the field of speech processing. A particular example of this would be a time scaling algorithm based on development to read text to visually impaired. Next is time reversal. Now, the first diagram is the original signal x of t and second is the time reversal of x of t. That is, x of minus t is the second signal. So until now we have assumed our independent variable representing the signal to be positive, but why should this be in case it cannot be negative? It can be negative, that is, here it can be negative, which is shown in the diagram. In fact, one can make it negative just by multiplying it by minus 1. So this causes the original signal to flip along its y-axis, that is, it results in the reflection of the signal along its vertical axis of the reference. As a result, the operation is known as the time reversal or the time reflection of the signal. For example, let us consider the input signal as x of n, and the effect of substituting of minus n in the place of n results in the signal yn. Now the time reversal is an important preliminary step when computing the convolution of the signal. So one signal is kept in its original state while the other is mirror image and slid along the former signal to obtain the result. The time reversal operation therefore useful in various image processing procedures such as edge detection. The time reversal technique in the form of time reverse numerical solution simulation method can be effectively used to determine defects. For example, the TRNS, that is time reverse numerical simulation method, aids in finding out the exact position of a notch which is a part of structure along with a guided wave propagates. So natural So here the operation is the reversal of the time axis or flipping the signal over the y axis. Next is amplitude of scaling, amplitude scaling of the signal. So amplitude scaling is very basic operation performed on the signal to vary its strength. It can be mathematically represented as yt is equal to a of x of t. What is a? A is a scaling factor, where if a is less than 1, then signal is attenuated, and if it is greater than 1, then signal is amplified. So this diagram is shown here, where the signal is attenuated when a is equal to 0.5 in figure B. Figure B, A is original signal. In figure B, the signal is attenuated at 0.5 value, and in C the amplified when alpha or A is equal to 1.5. So when a is less than 1, it is attenuated, and if it is greater than 1, then the signal is amplified. Next is addition of the signal. Now the addition of the two signal is nothing but the addition of their corresponding amplitude, and this particular operation involves the addition of the amplitude of two or more signal at each instance of the time or any other independent variable which are common between the signal. Addition of the signal is shown in the diagram below. where x1 of t and x2 of t are the two time dependent signals performing the additional operation on them. So we get yt is equal to x1 of t plus x2 of t. So x1 of t has some value, x2 of t has different value. So y of t is the addition of these two, that is addition of the amplitude. So at -2, it will be -2 -2. At -2, it is 2 plus 1. 2 plus 0 is 2. At value 1, it is 2 plus 2 is 4. At 0, it is 3 plus 2 is 5. At 1, it is 3 plus 0. Not at 1, at 2, it is 0 plus 2 is 2. So, addition of the two signals is nothing but the addition of their corresponding amplitude. X1 of t and x2 of t are the two continuous time signals, then the addition of these two signals is x1 of t plus x2 of t. The resultant signal can be represented as y of t, where yt is equal to x1 of t plus x2 of t. For discrete time signal, x1n and x2n you can write. So yn is equal to x1 of n plus x2 of n for a discrete type of the signal. So all the values of the resultant signal can be obtained by adding the corresponding values of the signal x1 of t and x2 of t. Although we have depicted the example of continuous time signal, the conclusion certainly holds good for even discrete time signal. Now the practical aspect in which the signal addition plays its role in the case of transmission of signal through a communication channel. This is because we see that the undesired noise gets up with the desired signal. Next is subtraction of the signal. So sorry, next is multiplication of the signal. Like addition, multiplication of the signal also falls under the category of basic signal operation. Here, multiplication of the amplitude of two or more signals at each instance of the time or any other independent variable is done, which are common between the signals. The resultant signal we get has the value equal to the product of the amplitude of the parent signal for each instance of time. Multiplication of the signal is shown in the diagram, where x1 of t and x2 of t are two time dependent signals on whom, after performing the multiplication operation, we get yt is equal to x1 of t into x2 of t. So, similar to the addition, subtraction, the mathematically this can be written as yt is equal to x1 of t into x2 of t. This is for continuous time signals x1 of t and x2 of t. And yn is equal to x1 of n into x2 of n. This is for discrete time signals x1n and x2 of n. So the multiplication operation results in the generation of the signal whose value can be obtained by multiplying the corresponding values of the original signal. This is true irrespective of whether we are dealing with a continuous time or discrete time signal. Now, multiplication of the signal is exploited in the field of analog communication when performing amplitude modulation. In AM, that is amplitude modulation, the message signal is multiplied with the carrier signal so as to obtain a modulated signal. Now, another example in which signal multiplication plays an important role is the frequency shifting in RF, that is radio frequency system. Frequency shifting is a fundamental aspect of RF communication, and it is accomplished using a mixer which is similar to the analog multiplier. Next is differentiation of the signal. Now, for the differentiation of the signal, it must be noted that for differentiation of the signal, It must be noted that this operation is only applicable for only continuous signal, as the discrete function cannot be differentiated. The modified signal we get on the differentiation has a tangential values of the parent signal at all the instants of the time. So mathematically it is expressed as yt is equal to d of xt by dt. So first signal is x of t, second is x of t dt, its integration, third one is cos of omega t, and fourth is sine of omega t. Then a signal is differentiated to determine the rate at which it changes. That is, if x of t is the continuous time signal, then its differentiation yields the output signal y of t. So yt is equal to d by dt of x of t. Now the figure shows the first derivative. The differentiation of the signal takes the form of the gradient operator in the field of image or video processing. In the case of image processing, the gradient technique is popular method which is used to detect the edges of in the given image. With video processing, this operator is used for the motion detection. So this kind of processing is important in the field of robotics. And in addition, many control and tracking applications such as aeronautical system make the use of real-time differentiators. This is because these applications require highly accurate data pertaining to velocity and acceleration. So by using differentiator, this data can be obtained directly from the position sensors, reducing need for the other sensors. There is one more operation, that is integration of the signal. Like differentiation, the integration of the signal is also applicable to continuous time signal. The limits of the integration will be in the form of minus infinity to represent the instance of the time t. So mathematically we can write this as y of t is equal to integration goes from minus infinity to t x of t into dt. So the integration is the counterpart of the differentiation. If we integrate a signal x of t, then the result y of t is represented as integration of x of t. Graphically, the integration computes the area under the curve of the original signal. As with differentiation, we can integrate a signal multiple times. The integration is the fundamental in signal processing operation such as the Fourier transform, correlation and convolution. These are in turn used to analyze the different properties of the signal. Other applications that employ integration are those in which small input currents are converted via integration into large output voltage. The charge amplifiers are used with the piezoelectric sensor, photodiode and CCD imagers. Also, the charge amplifiers can be used to convert an accelerometer output into velocity and displacement signal, because integrating acceleration yields a velocity and integrating velocity yields a displacement. Next is the subtraction. So the subtraction of the two signal is nothing but the subtraction of their corresponding amplitude, and this can be best explained by this example. So here is a diagram. X1 of t and x2 of t are the two signals, and the x of t is the subtraction of x1 of t and x2 of t. So here subtraction of the amplitude takes place. So similar to the case of addition, subtraction deals with the subtraction of two or more signals in order to obtain a new signal. So mathematically, it can be represented as yt is equal to, or x of t is equal to x1 of t minus x2 of t. This is for continuous time signal x1 t and x2 of t. And yn is equal to x1 of n minus x2 of n for the discrete time signals x1n and x2n. Even in the case of subtraction operation, all the values of the resultant signal yn can be obtained by subtracting the corresponding values of the signal x1n and x2 of n. This is evident from the discontinuous line. So it can be stated that the conclusion we arrive in the case of subtraction operation is similar to that of the addition operation, and it applies to both the continuous and discrete time signals. One practical aspect which connects with that of the subtracting the signal is that of moving target indicator, that is MTI, which is used in radar communication. The most recent signal is subtracted from its previous version so as to obtain the signal which indicates just moving the target by eliminating the stationary ones. This is very much necessary so as to facilitate the PPI, that is planned position indicator display of radar system. The another example which extensively make the use of signal subtraction is the design of closed loop control system. Such a system employ the negative feedback in order to accurately control an output variable, and this negative feedback structure realize upon the subtraction. The feedback signal is subtracted from the set point signal. So this is all about the basic operations of the signal. Next is control system. A control system means it manages, commands, directs or regulates the behavior of other devices or the system using control loop. It can range from a single home heating controller using a thermostat controlling a domestic boiler to a large industrial control system which are used for controlling process or machines. For continuously modulated control, a feedback controller is used to automatically control a process or operation. The control system compares the value or the status of the process variable, that is PV, being controlled with the desired value or the set point, that is SP, and applies the difference as a control signal to bring the process variable output of the plant to the same value as the set point. So control system can be represented by a single block, where since the output is controlled by the varying input, the control system got this name. So input and output, and at the center control system. Now we will vary this input with some mechanism. So for example, traffic light control system, washing machine, these are the examples of control system. Now traffic light control system is example of control system. Here a sequence of the input signal is applied to the control system, and the output is one of the three lights that will be on for some duration of time. During this time the other two lights will be off. Based on the traffic study at particular junction, the on and off time of the lights can be determined. Accordingly, the input signal control the output, so the traffic lights the traffic light control system operates on time basis. Next is classification of control system. Now based on some parameter, the control system can be classified into different ways. So first is continuous time and discrete time control system. Now control system can be classified as a continuous time control system and discrete time control system based on the type of the signal used. In continuous time control system, all the signals are continuous in time, but in discrete time there exist one or more discrete time signals. Second is SISO or MIMO control system. It is classified as SISO control system and MIMO control system based on the number of input and the output present. Now, SISO means single input and single output control system have one input and one output, whereas MIMO, that is multiple input, multiple output control system, have more than one input and more than one output. Now, next is open loop and closed loop control system. The control system can be classified based on classified as a open loop and closed loop control system based on the feedback. Now, in open loop control system, output is not feedback to the input, so the control action is independent of the desired variable. In open loop, the input is applied to the controller. It produces an actuating signal or the controlling signal. This signal is then given as an input to the plant or the process which is to be controlled. So the plant produces an output which is controlled. The traffic light control the system, which we discussed earlier, is example of the open loop control system. So next is closed loop control system. In closed loop control system, the output is feedback to the input, so the control action is dependent on the desired output. The error detector in closed loop, the error detector produces an error signal, which is the difference between the input and the feedback signal. This feedback signal is obtained from the block, that is feedback element, by considering the output of the overall system as an input to this block. Instead of the direct input, the error signal is applied to the input to the controller. So controller produces an actuating signal which controls the plant. In this combination, the output of control system is adjusted automatically till we get the desired response. Hence, the closed loop control system are also called as automatic control system. The traffic light control system having sensor at the input is example of closed loop control system. So there are some differences between the, there are some points which shows the difference between the closed loop and control loop, closed loop and open loop control system. In open loop, control action is independent on desired variable. In closed loop, control action is dependent on desired variable. In open loop, feedback path is not present. In closed loop, feedback path is present. There are these are also called as non-feedback control system in open loop. These are also called as feedback control system for closed loop. Open loop is easy to design. Closed loop is difficult to design. Open loop are economical. Closed loop are costlier. Open loop system are inaccurate, while the closed loop system are accurate. So these are the some points which shows the difference between the open loop and closed loop. Then the next point is types of feedback. There are basically two types of the feedback, positive feedback and negative feedback. Now what is feedback? If either the output or some part of the output is returned to the input side and utilized as a part of the system input, then it is called as a feedback. Feedback plays an important role in order to improve the performance of the control system. So basically there are two types, positive feedback and negative feedback. The positive feedback add the reference input, that is RS, and the feedback output. And the negative feedback reduces the error between the reference input RS and the system output. So the effect of feedback affect on the overall gain, also on the sensitivity, also the feedback on stability, it also affect on the noise. So this is all about the control system, basics of the control system. Thank you.